So good morning to everyone. Thank you very much to be with us to this SAI Cafe session organized by the International Relations Office of the Hellenic Mediterranean University and the European University of Athena. It's a great pleasure to have with us a colleague from the Hellenic Mediterranean University, Professor, Associate Professor Lazaros Junis. Few words about the speaker. Lazaros is an associate professor in the mechanical engineering at the Hellenic Mediterranean University. He has a high expertise in the advanced 2D and 3D printing and additive manufacturing technologies, utilizing functional nanomaterials for emerging applications such as energy, wearable electronics devices, electronics, and much more. He has he holds a bachelor degree in material science and engineering from the University of Ioannina in Greece in 2010. And he has performed his PhD at the Technical University of Dresden in Germany. The title of his PhD was Glass and Jute Fibers Modified with Carbon Nanotube-Based Functional Coatings for High-Performance Composites. Then he spent postdoctoral positions in the University of Dresden, Aristotle University of Thessaloniki, and University of Ioannina. His work has received more than 2,700 citations, and his age index is 29. He has attracted more than 2 million euros regarding very competitive research projects. And the title of the talk today will be Additive Manufacturing, 2D and 3D Printing Technologies, from 2D printed thermoelectric generators to 3D printed multifunctional nanocomposites. The floor is yours, Lazaros. Thank you again from the on behalf of the International Relations Office, on behalf of the Hellenic Mediterranean University. And the floor is yours for the next 40 minutes, and then we are going to have a time for questions. Thank you, Lazaros.
Thank you, Kostas, for the kind introduction. Actually, thanks everybody in the audience here, and let's pray. Actually, let me take the opportunity there to pray the best for the Ukrainian people. Actually, this meeting, first of all, I would like to share the presentation. So please kindly ask me, can you see my full screen?
Now, yes, we can see now the full screen. Thank you.
Excellent. So first of all, I would like to say thanks to my university, my Hellenic Mediterranean University, not only now, Kostas, that you are giving me this opportunity to speak and disseminate our activities in this field of additive manufacturing, but also for the university that gave me the opportunity in a quite young age to enter the academic world. And of course, I have to thank everybody starting from the very high level management of the university up to the colleagues and collaborators that are already started being quite active, I believe. So the title of the presentation already, you have said that we're going to discuss about 2D and 3D printing additive manufacturing. We're going to focus on some end use cases, which is thermoelectric generators and the 3D printed polymer nanocomposites. Thermoelectrics is a field that I have been working now 10 years. Let me say that I have been even one of the first people putting carbon-based thermoelectrics into the game. The story started in 2007. I have been publishing from 2010 in this field of carbon-based polymer thermoelectrics. And from 2000, already from my PhD times, I started working with polymer nanocomposites utilized for a 3D printing approach. Of course, as you may realize, I'm going to focus on fused filament fabrication 3D printing technologies that were utilizing typically polymer thermoplastic nanocomposites. So a few words about our university. Actually, everybody knows more or less where is Europe. Hellenic Mediterranean University actually is here. It's in the most southern part of Greece. We're very happy that actually Crete is the southest part, so it's quite all the year is quite enjoyable, I mean, due to weather and due to several other issues compared actually to my Germany times or to my Ioannina times, which is very north part of Greece. We're based in Heraklion. Heraklion is the biggest city in Crete. And our Hellenic Mediterranean University is a quite new university with a lot of success stories until now. And of course, Professor Petridis is also very much contributing in all this story about our university. So I will give you a very short outline about the presentation. First of all, I will give a short introduction about the activities just to get the flavor. Then I will pass to the 2D printing previous work I have done and end use cases, as well as 3D printing previous work. And then I will go to a short summary and a discussion with all the audience. Practical about the introduction, I will show you some basics about 2D and 3D printing technologies. Then I will show you some ideas about how novel materials can be integrated in these technologies. So we're matching and marrying the materials and smart materials with additive manufacturing. And both of these are correlated due to the well-known process structure property relationship. Then I will move towards the 2D printed previous works, some thermoelectric generators, as I said, some printed heaters, some actuators. Then I will move to the 3D printing work done so far. So basically fused filament fabrication and nanocomposite production and multifunctional 3D printed components manufacturing, and then to the summary. So just having a very fast, let's say, overview of the technologies, 2D printing is something that we can deposit, or we can create a final object based on an additive manufacturing process that, of course, the thickness is much smaller than the other dimensions. So in this direction, I have worked quite a lot in the well-known roll-to-roll printing. That actually is a technology now that is quietly used in many technologies like printing and manufacturing electrodes for batteries, photovoltaics. It's a technology also that we have obtained a funding in University of Ioannina, that I designed the pilot line that we have been able to coat carbon fibers practically, and then integrate the carbon fibers into epoxy to create the so-called prepreg materials, which are 2D manufactured materials. And then we're utilizing these composites layer by layer to manufacture the 3D well-known FRP fiber reinforced composites, which are used in many cases like aerospace, aeronautics, automotive, etc. So then just the big image of the 3D additive manufacturing is that of course we're adding layer by layer, and we're having a significant increase of the thickness in the final object. There are many technologies, as you may know, nowadays the 3D printing becomes more and more famous, and we're happy that in the HMU we're having a lot of equipment and a lot of actual, to my eyes, bright future in this very novel manufacturing technology. So just the big image about the 2D printing is some thermoelectric generators here. As you can see, we have published these results in Journal of Power Sources last year, in ACS Applied Material Interfaces also last year. We have been able, let me say, that at the moment we have published the most high power output thermoelectric generators with an efficiency at the moment of reaching to the 5%. So when we're having thermal energy loss, we can convert this thermal energy with such devices with 5% efficiency to electrical energy. Then the big image also about the 3D printing is that we're utilizing practically nanoparticles, mixing the nanoparticles via typically melt mixing processes, which is a polymer processing approach, into polymeric matrices, and then utilizing these polymers after the compounding process to extrude the well-known 3D printing filaments that we are using the filaments afterwards to print, as you see here, layer by layer, the final 3D objects. And of course, we have to take into account very much the rheology, the system, the nanoparticle filler loading, which is very, very important to have. You can see here a cross-section, a 3D printed sample cross-section with very, very less amount of intra and interlayer voids. So the big problem of additive manufacturing when we want to end up with a structural element is to avoid any kind of defects, internal defects, that, of course, due to fracture mechanics, they're going to have a very, very big impact to fracture toughness, either in mode 1, mode 2, mode 3, etc. So then I will move to the 2D printing activities. And of course, let me call it big lab, already now 10 years, more than 10 years working from 2010, the thermoelectric materials and the thermoelectric generators. Actually, It has been a problem in my PhD that I wanted to work. I was working with conductive materials, conductive polymer nanocomposites, and I was trying to find an extra functionality of these materials. So suddenly, I have exposed a polymer nanocomposite in a temperature gradient, and I have measured voltage. I mean, back to 2010, I didn't know what was thermoelectric actually. So then I realized that thermoelectric is a material that when it is exposed to a temperature gradient, it can convert the thermal energy to electrical energy. So the future of thermoelectric is very bright because just for the numbers, 66% of the energy coming that we're utilizing from any kind of fossil fuels is never used as a practical work or as a practical power. It's just disposed to the environment as thermal energy. And most of the cases, something in the range of 34%, were able to utilize as a practical work. The market of thermoelectrics is quite actually also very promising from 2014 to 2020. Let me say that this market contains everything that has to do with thermoelectrics, thermoelectric materials, and thermoelectric generators. So very fast, I will give you some very, very short introduction into the physics of thermoelectrics. Allow me please not to go into details about the band theories and more details about how this effect is generated due to the electrochemical potential and due to the Fermi energy levels, etc. Just very, very, very shortly to understand for physicists or engineers, thermoelectric is a material that it has to be a semiconductor because the metals actually they do not in a thermal gradient very easily cannot realize the thermal gradient because they have very high electrical conductivity due to the high number of free electrons and the lattice vibrations. So we cannot realize a gradient in metals. So it's a phenomenon that it has to work for semiconductors. For semiconductors, we have P-type or N-type. So in the case that we're having a hot end and a cold end, the free carriers of the P-type doped semiconductor or N-type doped semiconductor start moving very, very fast to equilibrate the energy from the hot side to the cold side. So practically, as you can realize, movement of carriers means current. So of course, then this current also is generated at the ends of the thermo element level, they're generating a voltage potential. So the very well-known and the very, very famous value there is the Seebeck coefficient, which is a property of material. And of course, the Seebeck coefficient then, as a definition, is deriving the voltage potential by the temperature difference. Some, of course, important values is the power factor, which is the conductivity multiplied to the Seebeck coefficient to the power of 2, the thermoelectric figure of merit, and the efficiency here, as you can see, that as I told you, we have been very happy reaching efficiencies of carbon nanotube materials, specifically single wall carbon nanotubes, in the range of 5%. And of course, we feel very, very much competitive to inorganic thermoelectrics because our single wall carbon nanotubes at the moment can operate in temperatures up to 400 degrees. And of course, they are still remaining stable. So it's not important to stay to the physics of thermoelectrics. Of course, it's a very important thing everybody to know, but the thermoelectric material has to be interconnected serially. So we have to create a serial interconnection of P and N-type semiconductors or a single thermoelement material like P and P-type serial interconnection. And of course, these are the building blocks of the well-known thermoelectric generator device. So the important thing at the end is to create a thermoelectric generator that in a large area, thermal energy, for instance, that exists in various applications, in various cases, it can be converted into electrical energy. For these people that they're familiar to this, or just the thermoelectric effect is the opposite of the Peltier effect. So in one case, we have a gradient and we're obtaining power. In the other case, we're giving power and we're generating a gradient. So this is one of the very, very nice works that we published in last year's actually, that we're having here a P and N-type thermoelements here and teleconnected. In both sides of this substrate, as you can see, we have printed thermoelements here, as well as in the top and bottom sides of the substrate. This is a Kapton substrate. So this means that we can go easily up to 400 degrees temperature gradients. As I said, this device has been the highest power output device until now published in literature. And we're working on that in printing technologies to manufacture several devices like this in a serial interconnection to be able to scale up the thermal harvesting properties, the thermal energy cases. Here you can see that from body temperature, that you can realize we can have a gradient 37, 36 degrees in our body, something like 20 degrees is outside the room temperature. We have been able to start harvesting energy. Also from a heater here, you can see also that we have been able to start harvesting energy and not only generating some voltage or some current, but being able with that kind of gradients, actually a wearable application here, to start feeding and start operating a step-up converter. So if we are able to activate a step-up converter, a commercial step-up converter, this for electrical engineer people, this you can easily realize that we can start then sending our energy to a battery or to a super cap, and of course making a practical use of this energy, as you can see here, for instance, that we can operate an LED device. This is the step-up electronics, as you can see here. And as you can see, for the temperature gradient of 6K, which is a very, very small gradient, we need 3,500 seconds to start transferring the power to the step-up converter electronics. Of course, you can see that with higher temperature gradients, we can reach much more smaller charging times. So we're very happy, but in any case, that at the moment we're able to reach with such a single device here ranges of voltage of more than 1 volt and of course more than 1 milliamp, which has been some target values, because if you are talking about with electrical engineers or electronic engineers that they are interested in harvesting values, always they ask you if you are able to reach values in the range of more than 1 volt, or if you can reach an order of magnitude of milliamps. So we're very happy that we can we're able to deliver these values now. And of course, we can do further engineering to optimize the internal resistance of the TG with the resistance of the electronics, because only in the case that the electronic resistance will match with our device resistance, only in that case, and we keep always that in mind, we're able to transfer the maximum possible power from our devices, which is the maximum power transfer theory behind. So another work that we have worked on, because of course we're not neglecting or we're not omitting and we're not underestimating works that have been related to inorganic thermoelectrics, has been to make some hybrid structures of tellurium nanowires. Tellurium actually is a very, very promising inorganic thermoelectric material at the moment, because it is inorganic from one side, but not so much toxic like the other thermoelectric materials which are well known, like the bismuth-based or the lead-based compounds. So we synthesize this tellurium nanowires, then we coat the tellurium nanowires with a polymeric-based material. So we make hybrid structures with control thickness of the polymer material in order to achieve an energy filtering effect. Energy filtering means that the tellurium nanowires have a very, very high Zibe coefficient. And with this coating, we tried to filter out the low velocity carriers, so to improve mobility. So we have to keep in mind that always improving mobility is an advantage for the Zibe coefficient. Like the opposite side, increasing the charge carrier density is not, it's not wise to do it against the Zibe coefficient. So we synthesized, as I said, this tellurium nanowires. Here you can see the very, very thin layer of the P.PSS material for the energy filtering mechanism. We have been able to make this 1D nanomaterials with very high crystallinity. You can see actually here the lattice fringes with 5.9 angstroms for the tellurium crystal, which is typical in that dimensions. In higher magnification here, you can see the thickness of the P.dot PSS layer. And based on that material, again, we have a 2D printed thermoelectric generator, as you can see here, a typical device that we used both silver as a metal contact, as well as single wall carbon nanotubes, as you can see here. And I have to say that we're very happy at the moment that we have access to single wall carbon nanotubes for many different applications like electrodes or for active thermoelements. Because let me say that back to 2010, I have purchased a single carbon nanotubes in my PhD. The cost was $400 per gram. Nowadays, the single wall carbon nanotube material, which is an amazing material to my eyes, costs something in the range of $7 to $8 per gram. So it was $400, now it became $7, $8. So these are again the devices. Always for the TEG devices, sorry. We are making the equivalent circuit and we're characterizing these devices with the well-known power curves. So here we can see our power here as a function of the load resistance. And you can see that the maximum power, which is here at this specific gradient or at another gradient or at another gradient, always the maximum power occurs in a load resistance, which is always very, very close to our TEG device resistance. We have also investigated these devices in terms of flexibility with different bending cycles. And we have seen that the single wall CNT contact is a very, very promising contact for the telluminant wires compared to silver contact, because we can go up to 1000 cycles without losing much significantly our internal resistance. We also investigated the stability operating in air of these devices. Actually, the P.PSS energy filtering thin layer on the tellurium nanowires has been very much protecting the tellurium from oxidizing in air. So we have been able to obtain an open circuit voltage of the device always constant for operating in air for a significant time of time. Let me say some few words about a project that it has been finished and now we're continuing actually with Airbus Group and Sonaca Group from Brussels and Airbus from France and Germany. They're asking us to print thermoelectric generators directly onto the reinforcements. So we're able to print the TEG device onto the reinforcement. This is a glass reinforcement. And then they're utilizing this TEG device to integrate it in positions in the airplane that there are hotspots. There are hotspots means that there is thermal energy which is released in the environment. So integrating these 2D printed devices, we're able to harvest this thermal energy from the aerostructure and convert it to electrical energy. So locally, we can start powering a low consumption specific sensors that they are of interest in the aeronautic sensor sector. Another work that we have worked on is also printing heaters. Actually, we had problems of starting printing some heaters with slow dye and blade coating 2D printing technologies. So we have came up with that structure, which is like a big ID electrode with a full coating of single wall CNTs. There are many works for heaters in literature, printed heaters. But most of the people are just putting on a specific area two electrodes. Let me say that this does not work simply because after offering the power to the resistor, to the heater, from some time, all the current starts being accumulated to the contacts, let's say to this contact or to this contact, to this contact or to this contact. So we have been able in advance to print this ID electrode. So we're able to, in smaller areas, to inject our current to our resistive element. We utilize this printed heater to integrate it, as you can see here, as a top lamina in a laminate composite. So we have utilized this heater as a de-icing function, as well as for curing the composite in an without using any oven or any autoclave performance. A de-icing function, as you can see here, that also were discussions with Sonaca, is to integrate it in the leading edge here, so the aeroplane. Here it's very important to have a de-icing function because if ice comes and gets accumulated there at that point of the wing, this can create a big problem to the flying operation of the airplane. So then very fast, I will move to some printed, actually blade-coated printed actuators based on our know-how on formulating PVDF with ionic liquid and carbon nanotubes. We have been able with melt mixing to disperse carbon nanotubes at the lower level of the electrical conductivity percolation threshold, so that the CNTs could crystallize PVDF into its beta phase, which is an electroactive phase, although PVDF is not so much active. And at the same time, we utilized also an ionic liquid, both to disperse, to help disperse CNTs in the melt mixing process, as well as to provide ions into the system. We utilized then this material, we dissolved it in DMF, and we printed with blade coating actuators. And of course, out of the final film, we just deposited two silver electrodes. So I don't want to go into details about the mechanism. The mechanism is a polarization mechanism that actually gives these electrostrictive properties to the final film. I will just show you a video to show that the actuator is performing very well. And this is actually under, this work is under preparation. You can set very low voltages in the range of 1 volt here. The actuator here that starts bends in 2 volts here, 2.6 volts. We still have to characterize with a laser displacement sensor the movement at the tip of the edge here of this actuator as a function of voltage. So this work, as I said, is ongoing work, and hope that we'll be able to have some support also from the university here to buy some equipment that we need to use in order to characterize these actuators. So then let me pass now to the work done so far in the 3D printing field. And as I said, basically we will focus on fused filament fabrication and polymer nanocomposites. That it's also a field that I'm working also now for more than 10 years. So practically, I will show you some very, very few results about our work. We're very active in, as I said, in polymer melt mixing. So we're creating our compounds, and then we're using these compounds to extrude filaments, as we see here, for 3D printing. In this specific work, actually, we created the nanocomposite filaments in situ. In situ means that we had our PLA matrix, and we mixed the PLA with polyethylene glycol and silver nitrate. So in that case, we're able to create in situ silver nanoparticles. And this actually process is called reactive melt extrusion or melt mixing process. So within the melt, we're able to reduce the silver nitrate, silver ions with polyethylene glycol to silver nanoparticles within the polymer matrix. So in that case, we're able to avoid any abrupt increase of viscosity or any viscosity issues during melt mixing processes. So practically here we have utilized, as I said, two different reducing agents, polyethylene glycol and polyvinyl pyrrolidone. In both cases, we have been able in a PLA matrix to realize the generation of silver nanoparticles. We have the best performance we have obtained with PVP and not with polyethylene glycol, because polyethylene glycol from one side functioned well to reduce the nanoparticles, but had a quite bad effect to the mechanical properties of PLA due to some plasticizing effect that created to the PLA matrix. As you can see, in both cases of PEG and PVP, the printed structures have been quite of high quality. So here you can see with an 3D optical microscopy that we do not have a significant number of voids here. This is a void, of course. This is an interlayer morphology. So it's the morphology from the side of the additive manufactured 3D printed object. But in both cases, we were obtained quite typical and similar morphologies with not a significant number of defects between the layers. Of course, as you can see, the PEG and the PVP, both of them have a plasticizing effect. So this is actually the reason that we can see here some defects like or some inhomogeneous morphology of the polymer material itself, as you can see here. but still this does not create a problem. Here you can see on the surface in some high magnification, some silver nanoparticles that start to appear in both cases here, as well as in the PVP case. Let me say that both for PEG and both for PVP, we have utilized two different amounts of PEG and PVP as an additive to generate the silver nanoparticles. We tested these materials for their antimicrobial performance. Actually, they have showed quite very high efficiency both for Staphylococcus aureus as well as for E. coli. So all these materials in this work actually have been antimicrobial, and the idea behind is that we can utilize this material to 3D print any kind of biomedical related wearable device, etc. Another work that we have also published is we have been asked actually by a surgery department to make these retractors. These are utilized in surgeries. So we printed these retractors, and afterwards with sonochemistry, we have been able to sonochemically mobilize silver nanoparticles onto the surface of this PLA. So we are utilizing a solvent. The PLA partially dissolves or swells onto the surface. Silver nitrate interacts with the PLA material with, of course, non-covalent interactions. And then we're adding the ultrasonic probe, which generates and gives the power for the reduction of the silver ions interacting with the PLA matrix. Now coming to some work that we're doing also with the 3D printing, as I said, there is a long history now from my, at least from my side, in polymer carbon 1D, basically 1D materials, carbon nanotubes, polymer conductive nanocomposites as a dispersed filler. As well as people familiar in this field, always we are very much looking into the percolation threshold. So we're trying to find what is the filler content that we have to go beyond in order to create an electrically percolated network so that we will be able either with a hopping or a tunneling mechanism to transfer charges from the one CNT to the other CNT. So in bulk, our material is going to be a conductive material. So there are a lot of works, as I said, for already from 2010, but one of the most I'm happy for this actual work, which is based for peak high performance, high temperature operating polymers with single carbon nanotubes that with melt mixing have been able to create thermoelectric nanocomposites. And let me say that at the moment, we are about to 3D print these materials to create with such materials a 3D printed thermoelectric generator. So just some final details about conductive polymer nanocomposites, CPCs. We have done quite a lot of work for PLA and carbon black. We have been able to find all the optimum properties to extrude our filaments, utilize this filament to create different samples for mechanical properties like dog bone samples or samples for three-point bending. All these materials we have investigated in terms of the electrical conductivity, and of course the carbon black in that case, in this work, we also used to see its antimicrobial performance because carbon allotrope, specifically carbon black, is quite promising filler as an antimicrobial agent. Our mechanical properties, recipe or experimental protocol always contains a tension sample, a flexural based sample, and an impact sample to see how the filler loading affects tension, flexural, and impact properties of the 3D printed samples. So as you can see here, this has been our conductive nanocomposites. Of course, it is reported in literature that we're having an anisotropic properties from the through thickness direction of printing to the cross layer thickness of the printing. This is something that we cannot avoid it, but we can improve it at some extent. So here you can see the electrical conductivity values up to the 5% of filler loading. I've been able to obtain quite high conductivity in the range of 1 Siemens per meter, which is a very good value actually for utilizing these materials either as heaters. Here you can see applying some voltage that the sample starts being heating up. Also here you can see an equivalent circuit that current passes through, so we're able to operate an LED device here. Of course, what I have to mention is that very critical is when we're starting adding fillers, it's a melt mixing process. So both for the compounding, we're having three processes here, which are very critical to the final polymer material that is going to be 3D printed. We're having the compounding process, which extrudes the material, so we can have shear-induced crystallization there. Then we're having the filament extrusion process, that again, we can have a second opportunity for shear-induced crystallization. And then we're having the 3D printing process, which is a filamentous extrusion process, that it is the third opportunity that the material will have the ability to undergo some shear-induced crystallization. For people that are familiar with melt mixing and extrusion processes, this is a very well-known issue that sometimes it is welcome to happen, sometimes not so much, because if the material becomes too much crystalline, then it cannot be easily processed via melt mixing, or we cannot have very homogeneous properties of the final extruded material. But of course, at the same time, an issue is the filler amount. So the filler amount creates, if the fillers are not well dispersed into the polymer matrix, could start creating some problems in the viscosity or in the homogeneous viscosity of the extrudable material. And these problems actually can end up to some not high quality of interdiffusion between the polymer chains from this filament to that filament, or from this filament to that filament. So the result of this is going to be that we're going to start having some intra-layer voids that, as I said in the early beginning, these voids are catastrophic for the fracture toughness of these materials. We cannot see so much these problems when it comes to a static tensile field, but when we're talking about fracture mechanics, the voids are creating a very, very big issue within the structure of the material. So then again, as you can see, playing with the voltage in 3 volts, we can see that we're having a low illumination. In 15 volts passing through our 3D printed material, we're having a higher illumination than LED, just as a practical property for some people that could be interested to make some flexible, for instance, 3D printed wires. As I said, we also started using these materials both for electrical conductivity as well as investigating their thermoelectric property, that we can use these materials in the near future to create our thermoelements for the 3D printed, fully 3D printed thermoelectric generator. Again here, that it has been work about polyamide 12 and carbon black, and polyamide 12 with the carbon nanotubes. As you can see, as a function of the filler content, always the CNT material is more conductive. And of course, we have been able to go up to 10%. 10% already increase the conductivity values, but the issue is that already it creates a knockdown effect in the mechanical properties. So one should counterbalance if wants to increase, have significant electrical properties, or have both optimum electrical and mechanical properties. And of course, this depends on the final application. If I may summarize a little bit there, I have to tell you that for the 2D printing, we're very active actually in the thermoelectric generators now, and we're running process basically on screen printing to be able to print more than 1,000 devices per day. And for the 3D printing, a field that we're very active at the moment is playing with the infill. So utilizing then the infill of the 3D printed structures to fill in with specific nanoparticles. So we do not have any more the nanoparticles to be mixed with the polymer that could have a big impact and a big issue for not high performance processes. Because if we want to extrude the material, if the viscosity is high, then this could create big issues both in the filament extrusion and both in the 3D printing FFF process. And with all that, I would like, of course, to thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you very much, Lazaros, for this nice presentation, an overall presentation of your activities, past and current ones. So if you don't mind to stop sharing the screen and give the floor to the audience for any questions from their side. So are there any questions from the audience? Let me, I mean, if they are not, I have some questions. Ah, okay, we have a question from the audience. So it comes from Professor Malavelakis. So Manos, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Lazarus, for your presentation. It was very impressive. The field of thermoelectric generators and your work was very impressive. I have a more general question. As far as I understood correctly, the most important disadvantage of the thermoelectric generator is the low energy conversion rate. It comes maybe up to 5%, correct me if I'm wrong. I think this is the most, led to this, that the thermoelectric generator are not widely used in large scale application. So I wanted to know your opinion about the future technology. Do you think that technology has some limits because maybe the law of physics of this effect, or do you think that someday we'll catch up to be a good competitor to photovoltaic cells, for example, the thermoelectric generator, or is this too much to expect for this kind of technology? Thank you.
Emmanuel, let me characterize it. This is an amazing question because this is the problem and this is the bottleneck. 5% is not, of course, enough. We cannot open the market with 5% efficiency. We are trying to trigger the market due to the fact that thermoelectric is something which is 24/7. So there are industries that 24/7 there is heat energy which is exposed to the environment, and of course it's lost to the environment. So this is the first strong point to say something against that. The second thing is that with carbon-based thermoelectric materials that actually I am active in here, other people in the HMU, of course I am quite optimistic that, not easily, but of course reading physics and going to the physics more in depth, we will be able to reach something in the range of 6 to 7%. But we need funding, of course. So, you know, for everything, funding is important. But of course, to my eyes, if you tell me at the moment that, okay, you have the funding, you have the project, you have the money, and you have to achieve 15% of efficiency, I wouldn't start running the project. Okay, it seems to my eyes at the moment that saying that we can reach 15% of efficiency at the moment is something which is, as far as I know, the field, and the physics behind, it's not very, very easy. And it's not very apparent that it can be done. With work and very, very focused work, we can go to 6-7%, maybe 8%. But as I said, if we reach this power conversion efficiency value, considering also that we are 24/7 operating and we're losing thermal energy, it is something that could have a strong point to come into the market. Of course, there is also the second, let's say, running or potential application that could be wearables. So for a wearable device, okay, you do not care if you have 3 or 4 or 5%, you can have 4% efficiency, but out of your body temperature, if you are able to generate power and start operating or giving power for an LED or any other low power consumption device, this is something quite important. I mean, and of course, somebody can say that, okay, we can put a photovoltaic, but of course, a photovoltaic maybe will not be able to work during night, of course. So, of course, photovoltaics is there, but it's 40 years, 50 years now of research. Thermoelectric is something which is there, but let me say, unfortunately for inorganics, I don't see a bright future. For carbon thermoelectrics, I see a very bright future, considering that nothing has been invested until now in this field. Nothing compared, of course, to other renewable technologies.
So, Lazarus, let me, I mean, I believe that technologies, they work complementary. So it's not, you know, we should not compare, you know, the technologies, but the technologies, they can work complementary. In some cases, you know, one technology performs better than the other one. Second, I have a question. I mean, regarding the performance, I mean, even the organic photovoltaics, they started with 3% performance, and now they have reached 18% performance. So my question, I have two questions on this. Is there any physical limit regarding the performance, the maximum performance of these kind of devices, like in photovoltaics, that there is a natural limit performance based to black body effect? And secondly, I mean, how do you envision to improve this? What does it mean that you can go 7% and you cannot go 15%, 30%? I mean, as a person of the field, what are you going to change? What we need to engineer in order to reach the maximum physical performance, if there is any maximum physical performance? What is your point?
Again, Kostas, a very good question. Actually, the top limit of the power conversion efficiency in these machines, non-moving parts machines, let me call it, is the Carnot efficiency. So coming now to our devices and our materials, I'm saying that the 5% now can go to 6% or to 7%, playing a lot with the crystallinity of the material. So we are having some ideas now. Of course, we're very happy and we have to say many thanks to the inorganic people, which is 40 years now research there. Of course, to Professor Dresselhaus, that in 1993, due to the quantum confinement effect, bringing into the game of thermoelectrics, we have been able to give again life to the thermoelectric field. So what I want to say is that at the moment we are working in some approaches. One approach is to try to make our thermo elements more and more phonon glass materials. Actually, it's very typical thermoelectric people that say that we have to make an electron crystal phonon glass material. Means that you are having a thermo element. This is a thermo element, and we're applying a temperature gradient. We need all the heat energy to stay here, to not to start moving even in an atomic scale within the crystal. So with our materials now, with our carbon nanotube materials, we're trying to make more and more phonon glass our material. So one idea now is that in the atomic scale, we cannot have, it's a ready-made material, the CNT, we cannot do many things. But in the nanoscale, because there are three levels of making a structure more electrically active or more thermally not active. Of course, we need very, very low thermal conductivity. So at the atomic scale, we cannot do much because the CNT is a 1D material. But in the nanoscale, we're working now on mixing single-gold CNTs with multi-gold CNTs. So the multi-gold CNT that's going to be a higher diameter material next to the single-gold CNT, it's going to function for endowing this phonon glass property in the nanoscale and in the mesoscale. Because in the mesoscale, even if the single-gold CNTs are nanodiameter-based materials, statistically, it's a homogeneous film. There is no phonon glass principle there. So mixing two different carbon allotropes, the one material will function for the other one as making more glassy the structure in the mesoscale, as I said. So this is one approach that we feel we're going to increase much our phonon scattering, so we're going to reduce a lot of the thermal conductivity, that it is an antagonistic effect in the figure of merit, the thermoelectric figure of merit. And of course, the thermoelectric figure of merit, it has to be increased more than 0.5 to 1. At the moment, we're in the range of 0.5 to 1 to 1. We have to go beyond 1 to start realizing efficiencies above 5%.
Thank you. Thank you, Lazaros. The floor now is to Professor Christakis. Then to Thanos. First, Professor Christakis, and then to Thanos Tiliakos. First, this was Professor Christakis. Thank you.
Okay, good morning, everybody. I feel really happy and impressed hearing from my colleague, a new colleague, unknown new colleague, Lazaros Tzounis, coherent and interdisciplinary approach to a concept that has a long past and for sure a long future. I will not speak long on the experiences you gave to me, dear. Let me call you Lazarus and call me Dimitris. We are in a scientific cafe. And I feel to say only a few words. I thought during your presentation, there is a very strong correlation between the electric and the heat constants. If we put in a diagram the electric conductivity versus the heat conductivity of simple materials, we will take a straight line. If we start building all those materials, this straight line will start providing different geometries. Your work is based on the forming, both in the chemical and mechanical level, of materials. So you have your attention towards a common structure, both in the very, very low level of structure and the mechanical, the visible lengths. I wonder how one could treat all those procedures using very low wave numbers, very low frequencies, very high frequencies, both in the mechanical, that is the heat, and the electrical, that is the light, not only the light, electromagnetic radiation, in order to help the matter to get structures that could behave in a form producing, for example, music, or be built under music.
Actually, Dimitri, you gave many ideas that actually I haven't planned to test. One idea, for instance, is in the thermoelectric generator devices, apply 90 degrees to the electric field, a permanent magnet, and see what's going to happen. So trying to bring into the game some Hall effects there. So utilizing the Seebeck voltage as a Hall voltage and boost more the thermoelectric generated carriers. It's a work that I have not done so far. It's within the plans. This is the first thing. And of course, the mechanical field there, of course, could give also a boost in the property, because mechanics can create vibrations. So the mechanical vibrations could interact with the rest of the fields. So at the end, an engineer, unfortunately, it has to be a very, very good physicist, a very, very good chemist, etc. Because at the end of the day, the most difficult problems, it's a combination of different fields. It's not only that I have a thermal field and I want to go into the electrical field via the thermoelectric principle. It's sometimes that I have what's going to happen if we're having all these fields in a mixed manner? What's going to happen? I'm very much interested into this mixing and trying to get from different fields, at the end, let me call it an added value, the final property. But it's not very easy in the lab environment to set up such protocols. But of course, it is a very, very, a promising way to bring into the game different external fields that might be the real case scenario in the real world, right? Because in the real world, in many cases, you have a mechanical vibrating field, for instance, at the same time of a thermal loss from a surface. It is within our interests.
So we may hear ultrasonic music in pictures of of electromagnetic waves.
Yeah, could be possible.
Okay, I have a second topic to discuss with you. What is the in the same frame of the interdisciplinary coherence? We are a scientific cafe. What is the interaction of social, economic, environment? The real social economic environment of Lazarus Junis today in Crete, with your dreams and your research goals. How do you feel that?
Actually, this is a difficult question, difficult to answer. And of course, I have to ask also my wife, because you know, the real boss in these things are ladies. But yeah, the real life is that, Crete is full of potential for renewables. So take into account that we can also work for the well-known field of photothermoelectric. So we can utilize the photon energy to heat up one side of the material and then again, via the thermoelectric principles, operate and utilize the thermoelectric voltage.
Okay, let me one last word on the Carnot efficiency. Carnot efficiency is defined on the concept of particles which moves and produce temperature as a result of the kinetic energy. So this coefficient, following my opinion, must not be put as a limit for the efficiency of the processes you are studying. Carnot efficiency is very good for thermal machines, which transforms heat to mechanical work. But when electromagnetic heat and structural coefficients, like heat coefficients, like conduction coefficients, etc., are defining the procedure, the behavior of your systems, then Carnot ideas are far away from reality. So in order to establish a frame on which you may build your theoretical conceptions, you should take some more general, some more primitive, some more axiomatically deduced concepts to define an efficiency coefficient. An efficiency coefficient. Let Carnot to the heat engines, to the internal combustion engines, etc. This is my opinion on how one could define the efficiency of heat conversion. And as a hint for this direction of research should be the the life. Life is starting from heat, okay, from radiation, from solar radiation, which produces heat, okay, but it builds new structures. I think that you are building new structures. And I strongly believe that your work will change a lot our opinions and our images and our dreams about engineering. I feel like saying a very great thank you to Lazarus Junis for all those new things is bringing in our department, in our school, in our university. And I really am very, very glad to have you, Lazarus, near me. And next time we will drink something together to discuss a lot. Thank you very, 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 very much.
It's my thank pleasure. Thank you, Dimitris, and thank you, Lazarus. So the physical limit is still open then. This is what I have realized. Of this device. Let's give the floor now to Thanos Tiliakos, that he waits very patient all this time. So Thanos, the floor is yours.
Do we have time or
we have time. We have time.
All right, so thank you very much for the presentation. It was very, very interesting. I'm doing something similar. I'm starting something similar in the near future, I mean this year. But I work with different systems. I work with different precursors for the 3D print material, which is in a dispersion form now. So you have solvent in both sides of the equation. You have solvent for the particles, and you have solvent for the plastic, let's say, itself. My question is this, it's totally practical, not philosophical anymore. Is there a cutoff point for the maximum loading of particles within the medium, after which you're going to get aggregation, for example, and negative effects, mechanical or electrical or whatever, for the application?
Yeah, of course. If we are talking about the polymer matrix, that any kind of filler, I mean, any kind, 0D1, D2D filler, above 5%, it creates a huge problem, both in the filament extrusion as well as in the 3D printing process. So it cannot be realized into a continuous large-scale production, commercial production, etc. Therefore, if you go for pastes, for instance, there is no problem. But for our polymeric-based materials, what we're starting now, and there is a very, very strong PhD student starting now under my supervision, we're going to make percolated conductive polymer nanocomposite, so with 1-2% filler loading, which is a conductive material already. And then we are going to play with the infills, starting from 10, 20, 50% infill. So then we're going to make porous structures. And in these porous structures, we will infiltrate nanoparticle solutions like carbon nanotubes. So in that case, we're going to use the porosity, to utilize the porosity to fill in with nanoparticles. Afterwards, we are going to thermally press the materials. So after the thermal press, we are going to make very highly conductive nanocomposites.
Like intercalation processes now you're talking about?
These structures are called as... it's not really intercalation. It's just filling the pores of the infill from the 3D printing with nanoparticles.
Yeah. Very nice, very nice. Just a quick introduction at the end. I'm one of the Greek scientists in the diaspora, and I'm working in Romania. I'm working for the Institute of Cryogenics in Ramnicu Vulca and the Institute of Laser Plasma in Bucharest, both. My issue is that I've been following the symposia of the university for quite some time now, maybe from the very beginning. It is my wish to reconnect to the motherland or fatherland, whatever, in the near future with some sort of collaboration, especially on this topic, 3D printing, because I started with 2D printing laser methods, laser pyrolytic methods, and I'm slowly transitioning to 3D printing. Is it okay to discuss it further via email for a future collaboration? Possible.
Yeah. I mean, no issue on that. I mean, there is a dream team of 3D printing here in Krim. We have also Professor Mavelakis here. We're having a strong team that we're working together, and feel free to discuss anytime and moving things forward and discuss at any level.
All right, perfect. Okay, let's see.
Actually, this is the purpose of the organization of these iCafe talks, to flourish, you know, collaboration between the different departments in different topics. So thank you very much, all of you, for this. Nice. And especially Thanos, probably we can invite you in one of the future colloquia talks to present your work in our iCafe. Please send me your email in order to contact with you. We have another question on the chat, Lazarus, for you. A part of the congratulations from our rector and other participants for your presentation. The question comes from a participant from Nepal, I think. Thank you, sir, for your nice presentation. How can we increase the efficiency of thermoelectric generators? This is something I think that you have already answered. And why we need high viscosity filament in 3D printing? So I will say that probably you should be focused on the second part of the question. Why we need high viscosity filament in 3D printing? Thank you.
Actually, maybe it has been misunderstood or I didn't explain it correctly. We need the opposite. We need a relatively low viscosity of the polymer melts in order to be processable either for the compounding extrusion process, either for the dilution and filament extrusion process, or either for the 3D printing extrusion process. So we need relatively low viscosities in order not to have clogging effects or issues related to the extrusion, in order to have finally a smooth extrusion process.
So excellent. I cannot see any other questions, and it's time also to close the session. We would like to thanks again, Professor Junis, dear Lazarus, for his contribution. And we are going to renew our appointment, how can I say, next week with another colloquia talk. So thank you very much, Lazarus. Thanks all the participants for their participation and also active engagement. And see you next week. Thank you very much. Yeah. Bye.
Thank you, Costa. Thanks, everyone. Bye-bye.